paragraph 21, dealing with the last of the additional problems which I'm going to address on all submissions to the court. And the submission is that THC performs acts in connection with the connection supply and transmission of cannabis. We deal with this in our heads at pages 45 to 48. And the court will recall from my submissions before the lunch adjournment that in addition to cultivation, the definition of dealing in relation to a drug in section 1.1 of the Drugs Act includes performing acts in connection with the collection, supply, or transmission of the drug. Now, the applicants say in their affidavit that once cured, a member's cannabis plant is packaged and labeled in a sealed tamper-proof bag, and THC notifies the member that their plant is ready for collection and delivery. Clause 11.1 of the THC General Terms and Conditions of Membership then provides that the member may elect to collect the cured plant from THC's premises, or elect to authorize THC to arrange on the member's behalf a courier service to deliver the cured to the member. But this is what in fact happens, is confirmed by the applicants in their replying affidavit in paragraphs 25.3 to 25.5. Now, we submit that if a member elects to collect the plant from THC's premises, unduly does so, THC performs acts in connection with the collection of cannabis in contravention of Section 5B of the Drugs Act, read with the definition of dealing in Section 1.1 and Part 3 of Schedule 2. And our further submission is that if the member elects to authorize THC to arrange the courier service, etc., THC performs acts in connection with the supply and transmission of cannabis in contravention of Section 5B of the Drugs Act, read with that definition. Pause at this point to say that similarly, the problems that we have identified are fundamental. They go to the reseeding and retention of the seeds, they go to the cultivation and keeping of the plants, and they go to the ultimate delivery. All integral parts of the grow club model, which you've been asked to declare as being consistent with the law post Prince 3. Each of these elements, particularly the central one of cultivation, they are essentials of this grow club model. I made a light-hearted submission before the adjournment, but our serious submission is that individually and cumulatively, they mean that the submissions are sound, the relief in paragraph 1 must be refused. Applicants? Essentially arguing for an extension into a commercial arena. This is not a mutual benefit society. It's one which is run as a commercial concern by Pt3, the company, in the form of a club, which is open to all members of the public who fill in the necessary particulars to register on the website and agree to the terms and conditions which my learned friend so thoroughly described. Outside the private sphere, in the commercial sphere. Sorry. The applicants argue in their heads, I didn't understand my learned friend to persist with this argument this morning, but it is in their heads at paragraph 79 that the words inserted into the definition of dealing by the Constitutional Court's reading in Prince 3 modify not just cultivation, but also the other elements of the definition. I just need to check with my learned friend whether that's which it also qualifies connection, supply, and transmission. As I understand the argument, it is, well, if this T particular cultivation by an adult for themselves in a private place or consumption in private by themselves is permitted, then any collection, supply and transmission in connection with that cultivation is also protected. That's the argument. We submit that the grammar and the syntax of the definition of dealing as altered by the Constitutional Court in paragraph 13b of its order in Prince 3 makes it clear that the cultivation is the only element of the definition which is qualified by the reading in. As I indicated earlier, it comprises a non-closed list of acts in connection with the drug, which comprise dealing. And each of those acts is separated from the others by a comma, namely acts in connection with its transshipment, importation, etc., all separated by commas. And the reading in is limited to the part of the definition starting with the word cultivation and ending with the comma after the word. In other words, it entails an exception or exclusion from cultivation, signified by the words other than. And as is to be expected, the content of the exception or exclusion is confined to a particular act in connection with the cultivation of the drug, namely cultivation by adults in a private place for their personal consumption in private. That the CC didn't intend to accept or exclude any other of the listed acts in relation to cannabis is confirmed by its statement of the effect of the reading in Prince 3 of paragraph 109. That's an important paragraph because it summarizes what the effects of the readings in part. Namely, and I quote, "The cultivation of cannabis by an adult in a private place for his or her personal consumption in private is no longer a criminal offence." And my lady, you just have to put those words on one side. And everything that my learned friend described this morning as to how the Grow Club model operates on the other side and the bits that I've referred to now. But the Grow Club just doesn't fit. It's outside the exception, the very limited exception granted. So for these reasons, we submit that the relief sought in paragraph 1 of the motion cannot be granted. And that then brings us to the declarations of unconstitutionality in paragraph 2.1 and 2.2 of the notice of motion, which are sought in the alternative. We've seen the amendment to the relief they are seeking, the deletion of the portion of those of paragraph 2.1 relating to the Medicines Act. So what they seek in effect then are declarations that if section 4B and 5B of the Drugs Act, read with part 3 of schedule 2, and in the case of 5B also with the definition of dealing in section 1, prohibit two things, then they are inconsistent with the Constitution and invalid. And what are the two things which they say render these provisions inconsistent with the Constitution and invalid? The first is the possession of cannabis by adult members of a grow club through the glow club model. That presupposes that the members of the club possess the cannabis through the grow club model. Now we've already seen their problems with that because it's the club which on this model possesses the cannabis. Possession certainly of the seeds is unequivocal, it's transferred to the club. There's equivocation in the terms and conditions about who has possession of the plants, but as a matter of fact, the club and the human beings through which Pty Limited, like the THC, operates, possesses the plants as well. The members on the common cause fact, they receive their plants only and possess them only at the end of a grave site. They send seeds, or they give permission to or they ask the club to take a cutting from another plant, which is then cultivated for them, harvested, dried, and cured. And when they come into possession is when they come to collect the cured cannabis, or it is couriered to them and delivered to them. Before that, the only relevant possession they have is the possession of the seeds which they send. But in the case of some members, they never send seeds at all. They get cuttings done under the two options to share, the 337, I think they are called, which is common, of course, that the model entails. So the factual problems underpinning this concept of possession, because in our respectful submission, the members don't, on the facts, possess. It's the club which possesses. That maybe they're possessing for someone else who's the owner and remains the owner. That doesn't make the club the possessor any less of a possessor. But that aside, they say that it is unconstitutional to prohibit the possession of cannabis by adult members of the grow club through the grow club model. And the other thing they say is unconstitutional is to prohibit the cultivation of cannabis for personal consumption by the adult members of the club through the grow club model. In other words, by professional horticulturalists working for the club. So we submit that the issues raised by this case are part of the case then, whether sections 4B and 5B of the Drugs Act, insofar as they prohibit the use, possession and cultivation of cannabis in terms of the grow club model, limit any of the rights in the Bill of Rights on which the applicants rely, and if they do, whether the limitation is reasonable and justifiable in an open and democratic society, taking into account the factors listed in section 31(6)(1) of the Constitution. As our learned friend did this morning, we deal specifically with the alleged infringements, one of which is admitted, and then with justification. We deal with the infringements in our heads at pages 54 to 77, but before addressing each of them in turn, we point out that in essence, the applicant's constitutional challenge to these two provisions of the Drugs Act is that the decriminalisation by the Constitutional Court in Prince 3 of the cultivation, possession and use of cannabis in private by adult persons for their own consumption in private does not go far enough. That's the basic contention. The applicant's core contention is that the rights in sections 9, 3, 10, 12, 2 and 22 of the Bill of Rights require that in addition, the decriminalisation of the cultivation of cannabis by grow clubs like the THC for their adult members' own consumption in private. That's essentially what you're being asked to decriminalise through this this matter. And before going into the each of the alleged infringements and then the justifications, we would ask the court to bear in mind the applicants are bound by the factual and legal bases for each alleged rights infringement, which was set forth in their founding papers. They're in paragraphs 99 and its subparagraphs. That's the only place where the court will find it. And we have attempted in what follows fairly to summarize what they say. And looking at my learned friend's heads and listening to her this morning, we don't think that there is any point of contention between the parties as to why they allege there are infringements. In other words, there's no disagreement about the interpretation of those paragraphs of the founding affidavit. What we've decided to do is to address these alleged infringements in the order in which they invoked by the applicants in their founding papers, starting with 99.1 and so on. So the first one then is section 9 sub 3, which is alleged direct unfair discrimination on the grounds of culture, belief, and socioeconomic status, and also alleged indirect discrimination on the basis of race. We deal with this in our heads at pages 9 to 10, paragraphs 11 to 12, and again in more detail at 54 to 58, paragraphs 133 to 148. As the court knows, section 9(3) of the Constitution provides that the state may not unfairly discriminate directly or indirectly against anyone on one or more grounds, including race, gender, sex, pregnancy, marital status, ethnic or social origin, colour, sexual orientation, age, disability, religion, conscience, belief, culture, language, and birth. The applicants allege in paragraph 99.1 that the Prince 3 legal dispensation infringes section 9(3) of the Constitution because unfairly discriminates directly on the grounds of culture, belief, and socioeconomic status against people who are unable to grow cannabis in their homes or home gardens, especially poor people who, due to their living conditions, for instance in informal settlements or apartments, are not able to grow cannabis in their private living space. So those are the people who are unable to grow cannabis in their homes or home gardens. Those are the people against whom this, in respect of whom the Pt3 dispensation does not go far enough and discriminates against them. The applicants also allege that because, due to the legacy of apartheid, most poor South Africans are black people and people of colour, the direct discrimination on which they rely also gives rise to or amounts to indirect unfair discrimination on the grounds of race, the breach of section 9(3) of the Constitution. That's in 99.2 of the founding affidavit. Now, before dealing with the evidence relevant to these contentions, we wish to make three preliminary points. The first is that none of the evidence substantiates the applicant's claims of unfair discrimination on the grounds of culture and belief. Evidence there on those two listed grounds. Secondly, although socioeconomic status is not a ground of unfair discrimination which is listed in section 9(3) of the Constitution, we accept that unfair discrimination on the ground of low socioeconomic status or poverty is analogous to unfair discrimination on the listed grounds. And the reason is it's based on attributes or characteristics that have the potential to impair human dignity or affect persons in a comparably serious manner. And that's, as the court will know, the touchstone for discrimination on unlisted grounds, analogous grounds, laid down in the terminal judgment of the Constitutional Court of Hoxton versus Lane. In this regard, we also refer the court to two other judgments, one of the Constitutional Court and one of this court. The first is Mashlangu's case. We apologize for not drawing this to our learned friends' attentions, but it's in their favour, so I'm sure they won't hold it against us. Where in paragraph 73 to 1 and post 7, there is a lengthy discussion which culminated in a holding that the exclusion from the compensation for, this case is in fact cited on the other side in this matter, that the exclusion from the Compensation for Occupational Injuries and Diseases Act of domestic workers employed in private households, most of whom are black women, amounted to unfair discrimination on the listed grounds of race and gender and on the unlisted ground of what we have called social class. Various terms are used by Justice Victor for the majority in that judgment. We also refer the court to Social Justice Coalition and Others versus the Minister of Police and Others, a 2019 judgment of this court, paragraphs 56 to 65, Justice Dulamo with Justice Bukwana. That was the case about the allocation of police resources or under allocation to Khayelitsha specifically. There it was held that discrimination on the basis of poverty was an unlisted ground prohibited by the Promotion of Equality and Prevention of Unfair Discrimination Act. As the court knows, that act was enacted in terms of subsection 9, or section 9 of the Constitution, to prevent or prohibit unfair discrimination. So it is the Act of Parliament giving effect to, in the first instance, primarily giving effect to section 9(3). The third preliminary point is that the applicant's allegations of unfair discrimination on the grounds of socioeconomic status and race are based on a misconception. And we'll recall that the focus there is on people who, because of their people who are unable to grow cannabis in their homes or home gardens. That's the focus. And the misconception is one to which my learned friend adverted this morning. We read it too when dealing with Pt3, and that is that Pt3 is expressly not limited to growing cannabis in adult persons' homes or home gardens. It extends to any private place. The Constitutional Court made it clear in paragraphs 85, 98 to 100 and 108 that not just about one's home, it extends to other private places. And that's something you did explore with my learned friend this morning in the context of a private place. I have a private place, for instance. Our home is just for to store some of the things that we've accumulated over the year. We rent a unit in a storage facility which is locked, in which things like items which you'd inherit from parents and so on are kept. That's a private place, at least I regard it as such. Now, in relation to this matter, this is the only issue on which this court is faced with a material dispute of fact in relation to the 9-3 claim. And it's about whether persons living in apartments, informal settlements, or other confined spaces are unable to cultivate cannabis in private for their personal consumption. Applicants allege that such persons are unable to do so in both paragraphs 99.1 and 99.2. But that's denied by the respondent's main opponent, Lieutenant Colonel Smith. Now, he, as the court will have seen from paragraph 6 of his affidavit at page 373, is a SAPS member with 25 years' experience in the Narcotics Bureau and the Narcotics Section of the Organised Crime Unit. He's the head of that unit in the Western Cape. He has extensive exposure to and training regarding drug-related offences in respect of cannabis. And as he explains, cannabis was and is widely cultivated, trafficked, and used in South Africa. That doesn't appear to be a disputed fact. So, to put it shortly, Lieutenant Colonel Smith is a very experienced narcotics South African Police Service member. According to him, and he substantiated this with photographs which the court would have seen, cannabis can be grown in small spaces, including in pot plants on balconies or windowsills and in backyards and informal settlements. He says that significant space for outdoor cultivation and or significant equipment for indoor cultivation are the prerequisites for the successful cultivation of cannabis for private use. We've seen the Constitutional Court was at pains to say that large quantities of cannabis aren't protected by its dispensation. Our submission is that in accordance with the Plascon evidence principle, his version must be accepted. In other words, this aspect of the case must be approached on the basis of his evidence, and if that is done, it means that the Pt3 legal dispensation does not discriminate unfairly on the grounds of socioeconomic status or race, because the factual underpinning for it is absent from the facts which this court is bound by that principle to accept as the right for the adjudication of this case. Isn't it trial? The court doesn't have an application before it for a referral to our evidence. And so these rules, which are designed to make our motion courts work, apply. And it's the respondent's version which is the version on which the court decides that aspect of the case. We submit, however, there are two further difficulties with the applicant's allegations of unfair discrimination on the grounds of socioeconomic status and race. The first is conceptual in nature. It concerns the contention that adult black persons living in close quarters and apartments, informal settlements and other confined spaces have no private places for themselves and their families within which they will free grow cannabis for their own personal consumption. We respectfully submit that this contention is incompatible with the protection of the right to privacy in section 14 of the Constitution, to which such persons are undoubtedly entitled, despite their cramped living condition. A learned friend in argument this morning mentioned the fact that in relation to an informal backyard situation, that children would have access to that. Our response to that is we accept that there is a likelihood that in many instances the children of an adult growing cannabis, this is not in the note, in a backyard for his or her own consumption, will have access to the area where the cannabis is being grown. That's so the reason for that is obvious. Children who live with their parents have access to their homes. But that fact in our submission doesn't mean that the home is not a private place. Indeed, the home is part of the core of the privacy which is protected by the right to privacy. And one sees that from paragraph 44. quoting paragraph 73 of the CC's judgment in Bernstein, the court held that the right to privacy concerns, amongst other things, and I quote, private family and home life. And as the Concord further confirmed in Prince Street at paragraph 49, quoting its earlier judgment in National Coalition at paragraph 35, and I'll read you the relevant portion of the quote. In the context of privacy, it is only the inner sanctum of a person, such as his, her family life, sexual preference, and home environment, which we obviously emphasize, which is shielded from erosion by conflicting rights of the community. So the parts of an adult person's home, this is our submission to which the children have access, are a private place, as envisioned by Prince Street. So with respect, whether or not children have access to the place is for purposes of the Prince Street dispensation red herring. It may give rise to other problems for the parents if the children were to use the camera, to hold it and use it. But we're not dealing with any allegations in that connection in relation to Prince Street made by the applicants here. There's a second difficulty with the applicant's allegations of unfair discrimination on the grounds of socioeconomic status and race, and it concerns THC. If one has regard to the notice of motion, paragraph 2, where one is talking about the grow club model, it seems clear to us that the grow club model is the one as defined in paragraph 1 of the notice of motion, which my learned friend took you to. It's one where the applicants rent out private space to the members by means of a sublease, wherein the members grow their own cannabis for personal consumption by employing the applicants as professional horticulturalists. They want relief, in other words, insofar as it relates to THC's grow club model. There might be other models we don't know, but it's that one. And there's a particular problem with the THC grow club model, and that is its fee structure. Court knows what its fee structure is. The cheapest membership option is this one called the threesome at 485 rand per month. We submit the evidence shows that that renders the model inaccessible to the very poor persons on which the applicants seek to rely for the decriminalisation of the model. They say in their papers, their replying papers, that a THC member with this membership option will obtain 10 grams of cannabis every 2 months at a total cost of 970 rand, in other words, 485 rand for the 2 months. So that yields a cost of 97 rand a gram, which is far higher than the cost of cannabis grown outdoors, which according to Lieutenant Colonel Smith, sales will be at a peak for between 2 rands and 8 rands a gram, depending on the variety. So all other things aside, this grow club model can't be the solution to the unfair discrimination on the grounds of socioeconomic status and race on which the applicants rely. With respect, it seems that this is an unmeritorious argument which just doesn't fit the facts of what the applicants are doing. The second is section 22, the infringement of the rights to choose and the alleged infringement of the right to practice a trade, occupation or profession. The allegation in paragraph 99.3 is that the Prince Street legal dispensation infringes the right both to choose and to practice. Infringement of the right to practice is because it amounts to irrational regulation of the practice of a trade, occupation or profession, contrary to section 22. And my learned friend has referred you to the Diamond Princess case and different standards for the infringement applicable there. And now we deal with this contention in our heads at pages 59 to 61. The court knows what section 22 provides in two separate sentences, the right to choose trade, occupation, or profession freely, which in here is a different citizen. And facts on which they rest is irrationality, the allegation in relation to the regulation of the trade that lacks the key element of the factual foundation. The two comparators both are in fact unlawful. Having said that, as the court knows, our clients accept that the Pt3 legal dispensation limits the right of citizens in the first sentence of section 22 because they cannot choose the cannabis grow club trade freely. And they cannot choose the trade of cannabis horticulturalist or profession, I suppose we could call it, occupation, gardener freely either. It's because it prohibits anyone, including any citizen, from establishing or running the cannabis grow club, in which the club grows cannabis for its members, and it prohibits anyone from working as a cannabis horticulturalist or gardener for such a cannabis grow club. And for reasons which we shall give shortly, when dealing with the issue of justification, in our submission, these limitations of the right in the first sentence of section 22 are permitted by section 36(1) of the Constitution. We don't accept, for two reasons, that the Pt3 legal dispensation limits the rights of citizens in the second sentence of section 22. The first is that it doesn't regulate the cannabis grow club trade, it prohibits it. And the second is, although the Pt3 legal dispensation does regulate the occupation of cannabis horticulturalist or gardener by requiring that they be people mentioned in paragraph 3 of section 5b to the Drugs Act, or adults cultivating cannabis in a private place for their own personal consumption, it doesn't do so irrationally. On the contrary, the court's insistence in Pt3 that absent compliance with the Medicines Act, as envisaged in section 5b3, to be legal, the growing of cannabis by a person must be for their own personal consumption is rational. And there are two reasons why that is so. The first, as I've repeatedly stressed, is the constitutional basis for the Pt3 legal dispensation is the right to privacy. And the core of that is the intimate personal sphere of human life. One sees that from Bernstein in paragraph 67.
What do you do if you're a person who enjoys cannabis?
You cannot, or if for whatever reason you can't grow your own, the Pt3 legal dispensation doesn't allow you to do that. You have to grow your own.
So if you can't grow your own, you can't use for recreational purposes?
You can't. It permits. So it's interesting, if one has a look at the orders in Pt3, the readings in. Grow your own one, that is to take it outside the offence of dealing in section 5b. So that's at paragraph 13b of the order. So if you cultivate your own, you're not liable to be convicted of dealing. Possession is dealt with in 4b. You're entitled to be in the possession of cannabis and to use it if you do so in private. In other words, if you possess it in private for your own personal consumption in private. What Pt3 doesn't deal with is any way other than cultivation through which you get to come into possession of it. And what it expressly says is you certainly can't buy it. Where the member supplies seeds to other people
making in relation to why it was rational regulate this trade, why it is rational to regulate the occupation of cannabis horticulturalists and gardeners by requiring that they be people who are licensed under Section 5B of the Drugs Act to avoid the dealing, otherwise dealing liability, or to be people cultivating cannabis in a private place for their own personal consumption. Why is that rational? Perhaps that's just on a lighter note. I find this case rather strange. The first time, as far as I know, that any court has been asked to declare unconstitutional a regime created by the Constitutional Court itself. And so it's not so much a question of what the legislature was about, but what the Constitutional Court was about. So the, to interpret what the order means and what's permitted and not, one has to look at, obviously, the order in the context of the judgment as a whole. The case is clear on that. If one looks back into the judgment, what does one see? One sees that there is a repeated reference to the Bernstein conception of privacy. There's quite a long discussion of what privacy entails. And the core of that is the intimate personal sphere of human life, as I've indicated. And in Pt3, the court held that the right to privacy includes the right on the part of all adult persons to cultivate cannabis in a private place for their own personal consumption in private. It's important to then note, well, what's the corollary of that? It's that each person's right to privacy doesn't extend to encompass a right to cultivate cannabis for consumption by someone else, which is essentially what the applicants are contending for, though they don't rely on the right to privacy, but they say it's irrational to approach it on that basis. Well, given the foundation for the principal judgments, it makes perfect sense. It is irrational with respect to the constitutional mode of reasoning. The second is goes to the issue we discussed before lunch, paragraph 88, and it's the fact, which will weigh heavily also in the justification analysis when I get to that in a moment, that the cultivation of cannabis by people for consumption by others may be an element or a stage in the trade in cannabis. And the inclusion of the cultivation of cannabis, other than its cultivation by an adult in a private place, etc., in the definition of dealing, is there precisely for that reason. That's why dealing includes cultivation. And as explained earlier in Pt3, CC held that dealing in cannabis is a serious problem in the country, and it is a justifiable limitation of the right to privacy. They said as much in paragraph 88. Admittedly, that was in the context of a particular facet or aspect of dealing, which was sale and purchase. But the court was well aware of the statutory context in which, within which it was operating, as evidenced by its orders of unconstitutionality, and particularly its reading in order. When what did it amend in this context? Only the definition of dealing. It didn't create an exception as it did a new paragraph 5, I think it would have been, in Section 5B of the Drugs Act, like the subparagraph 7 it created in 4B. It needed dealing. So for these reasons, we submit that there is an infringement of the right in the first part of Section 22, but there isn't an infringement of the right in the second part. That then brings us to the infringement of the right in Section 12.2 of the Constitution to bodily and psychological integrity. The allegation here in paragraph 99.4 of the applicant's confining affidavit is that the Pt3 legal dispensation infringes that right, including the right to security and control over persons' bodies, because it denies persons who are not able to cultivate cannabis in their private spaces at home, and consequently join a grow club, the opportunity to choose to use cannabis as a relaxant for their emotional and mental pleasure. The relevant part of Section 12 to the Constitution does indeed provide that everyone has the right to bodily and psychological integrity. There are two main difficulties with the infringement of this right on which the applicants rely. We've addressed both of them already when dealing with the case based on Section 9.3. infringement is incompatible with the respondent's evidence regarding the ease with which cannabis can be cultivated, even in small spaces, for example, in pot plants using natural light. That's on the supposition that one is limited to your home. That then brings me to the alleged infringement of the right to dignity. Now, there's no need for us to make too much of this because of the admitted infringement of the first section of section 32. But I do think it's helpful in this regard, in relation to our submission, that this is a make way to have regard to what the applicants have been here. Can I ask the court just to turn to paragraph 99, which starts of the filing affidavit, which starts at page 53. It's a long paragraph. Under the heading, the constitutional rights that are infringed. And what one then sees is the alleged infringements in 99.1, that's direct discrimination, that's section 93, 99.2, indirect discrimination, 99.3, infringement of the right in section 22, detail, 99.4, the right to which we've just referred, that is the section 12.2 right. When one gets to the dignity, one sees it in 99.5, the following allegation: I'm advised that personal choice and autonomy are indispensable elements of the right to human dignity. For the reasons addressed above, I submit this right too is infringed in the present instance. There's no additional reason. They rely simply on what they say in relation to the other infringements for which they contend the applicants do. Now, section 10 of the Constitution is indeed a very important right. It's important because it has to do with human dignity. Headed human dignity, and it means everyone has that inherent dignity and the right to have their dignity respected and protected. And part of its importance is illustrated, amongst other things, by the fact that the founding values of the Republic include in subsection 1A human dignity. So among the rights in the Bill of Rights, human dignity, the achievement of equality, and the advancement of human rights and freedom. So human dignity is mentioned right up front. And it also plays an important role in the limitations analysis under section 36.1, where the yardstick is the extent to which a limitation is reasonable and justifiable in a society, open and democratic society, based on human dignity, equality, and freedom, and taken into account. So it is undoubtedly an important right. But with respect, there are two difficulties with the invocation of the right to dignity here. The first relates to the Constitutional Court's reasoning in the Prince judgment, and the second to the role that dignity plays in relation to the other rights on which the applicants rely. Dealing first then with the Prince judgment. In reaching its conclusion that sections 4B and 5B of the Drugs Act infringed the right to privacy in section 14 and was invalid, the Constitutional Court considered the relationship between the right to privacy and the right to dignity in section 10. It did so in paragraph 50. And there, the Constitutional Court quoted its earlier statement in Kamalu's case at paragraph 27, that, and I quote, "There is a close link between human dignity and privacy in our constitutional order. The right to privacy entrenched in section 14 of the Constitution recognizes that human beings have a right to a sphere of intimacy and autonomy that should be protected from invasion. This right serves to foster human dignity." So by fashioning the readings into sections 4B and 5B, it did, the Constitutional Court remedied the inconsistency with the right to privacy, which gave rise to the Declaration of Constitutional Validity. CTM section 10 is unsound because it was taken into account when informing the content of the right to privacy which the court found to be infringed. The second, which relates to the other rights which the in the Bill of Rights which are invoked by the applicants, our submission is that all of them, including the right to choose a trade freely, and we didn't understand how we're in a trend for the applicants to continue otherwise this morning. That one we submit is the right which is directly implicated, the only one which is infringed. But that right and the right to bodily and psychological integrity, to which the applicant's reference to personal choice and autonomy apparently relates, they are all informed by the right to dignity. We refer in this regard to the Book of Curry and Naval, the Bill of Rights Handbook of 250 to 253, that's the introduction to that section, under the heading The Centrality of Human Dignity and the Constitution. And I think this explains why the applicants, on advice, because that's what they say in section 99.5 of the founding affidavit, alleged that the Pt3 legal dispensation infringes the right to human dignity for the reasons given above. We accordingly stand by our submission that the infringement of the other rights of the Bill of Rights is what's central here. It's not a question of a freestanding infringement of dignity. Many rights, including particularly the right to trade free and to choice occupation, etc., under Section 22, are informed by dignity. We accept that. But one's got to focus on what is the right that's infringed. Many of these rights are animated and informed by dignity. That then brings us to the justification leg of the case. Now, we've accepted that Pt3 limits the right of citizens in the first sentence of Section 22 of the Constitution. And to recap, that's because it prohibits any person, including any citizen, from establishing or running a cannabis grow club, which the club grows cannabis for its members, and it also prohibits them from working as a cannabis horticulturalist or gardener for such a club. The court knows that Section 36(1) of the Constitution provides that the rights in the Bill of Rights may be limited in terms of law general application to the extent that the limitation is reasonable and justifiable in an open democratic society based on human dignity, equality, and freedom, taking into account all relevant factors, including the five listed there, namely the nature of the right, the importance of the purpose of the limitation, the nature and extent of the limitation, the relation between the limitation and its purpose, and less restrictive means to achieve the purpose. The applicable legal principles pertaining to the limitation inquiry are well established, and several of them are set out in the applicant's case of paragraphs 50. Paragraph 107, it's a long paragraph on pages 57 to 58. We commend to the court in particular two of the cases which my learned friend addressed this morning, the Batsa SCA judgment at paragraphs 19 to 25 and the NICRA judgment of the Constitutional Court at paragraphs 33 to 37. And based on those judgments in particular and one or two others to which I shall refer, we would add the following considerations which are important for the decision of this case. The first is that if matters of fact and policy are intertwined, which we submit is the case here, and we shall elaborate on that briefly just now, then in the limitation analysis, not just facts but also policy considerations have to be taken into account. Secondly, although the party relying on the justification must establish the facts or any facts on which the justification a legislative choice is not always subject to courtroom fact-finding and may be based on reasonable inferences unsupported by empirical data. And that principle is particularly important when dealing with the evidence of someone like Lieutenant Colonel Smith about what the practical problems will be of the decriminalisation that the applicants are seeking. The question that the court must ask itself is it reasonable to infer from what Colonel as prohibited. That's a crucial point which the applicants appear to be missing. They're asking you, in advance of any amendments made by Parliament to the Drugs and Drug Trafficking Act, to create a sphere of commercial activity which will be permissible. And that, in the context of a general prohibition otherwise of dealing in cannabis, including its cultivation and sale. And it's that context, that disjunct, practicalities around that to which Mr. Kermit Smith's evidence is directed. We'll get to that evidence in a moment, but we do, with respect, submit that our learned friend's criticism of the evidence is unsound. You have before you evidence of an experienced policeman, experienced narcotics policeman, explaining what the practical problems will be if the court creates this limited sphere. Permitted cultivation in a sea of impermissible and continuing illegality until the legislation is amended by Parliament. The third principle concerns relying on policy. So when policy is an issue, the party relying on justification must place sufficient information to court as to the policy that has been furthered, reasons for the policy and why it's considered reasonable in pursuit of the policy to limit the constitutional right. So what I will say, just to press into submission I'll make in a moment about the draft cannabis master plan, which is a policy document following on an in principle policy decision by Cabinet in 2019 to move to the commercialization and consequently legalization, at least decriminalization of the cannabis trade more broadly. Is that the policy acknowledges that there are problems with cannabis. It is not an problematic substance, and it consequently requires careful legal regulation. So what is abundantly clear is that what the government has in mind is not the wholesale, unregulated trade in cannabis, and by trade, I mean in all of its facets, from cultivation through to marketing and sale. A wholly different model is envisaged, which is going to entail the re-regulation of this area of social life in South Africa. And that raises separation of powers concerns. Is it appropriate for the court to get ahead of the legislation and to make this exception in this case? We respectfully submit it's inappropriate because the decriminalisation of the dacha trade, we call it that, the cannabis trade, is quintessentially a matter for Parliament. The Constitutional Court has set its face against doing so on constitutional grounds. It says so in terms of paragraph 88. So the policy must be placed before you have before you the current policy of the government, at least when the papers were filed, I'm not aware of changing that. Then there's a question about effectiveness. This is the relation between the limitation and its purpose. And we shall, in a moment, be making a submission that the purpose of the current dispensation, which is to create a limited exception, there are really two of them. One is to vindicate the rights of adults to privacy. And the other is to avoid legalising the trade in cannabis. Is this unusual case where the dispensation that we're interpreting derives from a reasoned judgment by the Constitutional Court fashioning the current legal dispensation, and it's clear from that judgment that its refusal to confirm part of the High Court's order relating to purchase, that the court set its face against, on a constitutional basis, legalising the cannabis trade. So So the relevant principle there is, when it's not possible to prove that a policy directed to a particular legitimate governmental concern will be effective, if the concern is of sufficient importance, and this is clearly the legal cannabis trade, the risks associated with it sufficiently high, and there's a sufficient connection between means and end, in other words, the existence and enforceability of prudent provision can reasonably be expected to control the risks, that may be enough to justify the provision. And there may even be cases, the court added in my quote paragraph 36, where despite the absence of such information on the record, which is not the case here, the court is nonetheless able to uphold a claim of justification based on common sense and judicial knowledge. And then there are two other principles which relate to this element in section 36 of less restrictive means to achieve the purpose. And I would respectfully submit the Constitutional Court has made it clear that that is not an absolute requirement, it's a factor to be considered. In Mamabolo's case, at paragraph 49, the court held that the existence of the less restrictive means, so one as first finder, though an important consideration to be weighed up in the proportionality analysis, doesn't necessarily render a provision unconstitutional. And in fact, in the TDB clinic case, at paragraph 95, the court went further to say the state must be given a margin of appreciation in relation to whether there are less restrictive means available to achieve its stated purpose. And by margin of appreciation, that means a sphere or an area of immunity within which it can err without incurring the constitutionality as a consequence. Freedom to err. So the judge deciding the case might think that the government is wrong in its belief that there is the alternative less restricted means. But because this intrudes so obviously in most or many cases into the arena of executive policy making and parliamentary legislation, provincial legislation, the court correctly, with respect, says the state must be given this margin of appreciation. Now, for eight reasons, outside of the case, the respondents opposing submit that the infringement of section 4B and 5B of the right in the first sentence of section 22 is permitted under section 26. The first is the formal requirement, the drugs laws, the Drugs Act provisions are laws of general application. Secondly, we do accept that a person's work is part of their identity and is constitutive of their dignity. The Constitutional Court held that in paragraphs 58 and 59 and 62 to 63 of the Affordable Medicines Trust Case. Consequently, we accept the right to choose a trade is a powerful one, which is not likely to be limited. And we submit that the same applies to the other rights which the applicants alleged are infringed. So if this court were against us on any of those other rights infringements, we accept too that they are important rights not likely to be infringed. But as I've already explained, the cultivation of cannabis is an element or a stage in the trade of cannabis made. And in a particular case, in every case in which there is a trade, it is an element, and you may be dealing with a trade when you come across someone who's cultivating. And that is dealing. And the Constitutional Court has held that is a serious problem in South Africa and regarded a prohibition on dealing as a justifiable limitation of the right to privacy. So in the light of that finding, 30, we say it must be accepted, having regard to section 36.1, the importance of the purpose, that curbing dealing in cannabis is an important social purpose. And then, if one's looking at the nature and extent of the limitation, we submit that there are two things need to be kept separate. The first is the prohibition on establishing or running a cannabis grow club. Second is the prohibition on working as a cannabis horticulturalist or gardener for other people. The first, the prohibition on establishing a club, that's absolute. You can't do that. So that That's a total prohibition. The second, a prohibition on working as a cannabis horticulturist or gardener for someone else. That's not absolute. You may do that if you have a permit under Section 5B of the Act. So it's not as if no one could lawfully be a cannabis horticulturist or gardener in South Africa. They can if they've got a permit as in physical in Section 5B of the Drugs Act. Obviously, the fact that one has an absolute prohibition on establishing or running a club is something which requires more powerful justification than the more limited prohibition on working as a gardener for such a club. It's here that my submissions earlier about the current legislative environment come into sharp focus. In this environment, that is where large-scale cannabis cultivation for non-medical or non-research purposes is prohibited. That's the law at the moment. In that context that you've been asked to make this limited decriminalisation effect. In that context, in other words, where this is prohibited, large-scale cannabis cultivation for non-medical etc. purposes, if one is, one has to ask yourself, what is the alternative to an absolute prohibition? And the evidence which Lieutenant Colonel Smith has given substantiates the following proposition. Anything other than an absolute prohibition would render the policing, that is the detection and combating of illegal dealing in cannabis, very difficult and costly indeed. So he says, in other words, that in the current environment where there is this ban on large-scale cultivation of cannabis for non-medical or non-research purposes, if one was to create an exception, as the applicants would wish, for running cannabis grow clubs, that, the evidence is, will make the policing, detection and combating of illegal dealing in cannabis very difficult and costly indeed. We heard our learned friend this morning saying this is not substantiated. Respect, that's not correct. Paragraph 126 of the answering affidavit, which starts on page 413 and goes through to page 450, substantiates this in some detail. And the points which are made, there are four main points which are made in this connection. The first is in paragraph 126.1. And it is that a cannabis grow club closely resembles an illegal growing operation in the sense that the cultivation of large quantities of cannabis. That's a prime a sense check that must be right. We've seen 400 odd plants were encountered on the 13th of October 2020. That is far more than one would be growing for personal consumption, home consumption. It resembles what one would find in many operations where cannabis plants are being grown for illegal sale. The second point which he makes and substantiates with three particular scenarios is that cannabis grow clubs are open to abuse by their operators and by the members. And that's in the first part of 126.2. There is an unfortunate paragraphing mistake in paragraph 126.2. And that a hard carriage will turn about halfway down that on page 430 is not there. The punctuation is there, but the hard carriage return is not there. And I may just ask the court to turn that up. probably would have been more natural to start a new paragraph with the incentive for abuse is high, because that then substantiates the types of abuses which are given in the first part of that. And the court might want to just draw a vertical line before that sentence, the incentive for abuse is high, because that's a separate point. So the first is that they're open to abuse, and the related point is the incentive for abuse is high. Well, why does Colonel Smith say the clubs are open to abuse? Well, the first is it's by the operators and their members. As far as operators are concerned, he says, operators of a large grow club can intersperse cannabis they are cultivating, drying, or curing for members with cannabis they are cultivating, drying, or curing illegally for sale to cannabis dealers and users. So that also, if one applies a sense check to that, there can be no, there can be no quibbling with that sensitive observation made by an experienced person. He does not.
Because it seems, as his affidavit describes, it's purely speculative. Unless he has been grow clubs when he's encountered this.
He doesn't say this is the first grow club that he has encountered. But it does seem that this particular grow club, based on the finding affidavit, was a new idea, which the second applicant had based on his interpretation of Prince Street. And I say nothing about Mens Rea, that's a matter for another place.
That's a different order.
So we deal with a new idea. Before Prince Street, there would certainly be no traction whatsoever for the problem with which the court is confronted today. So I suppose, getting back to what the principles are listed. Employees to take up memberships of a grow club or of multiple clubs in order to acquire cannabis for sale. potential for abuse. They are open to abuse in various ways by the operators and by people using them, including by organized criminals, which many drug dealers are. It's part of organized crime. He says the incentive for abuse is very high. It's his third point, especially with cannabis grown indoors, which in the applicant's version is between 80 rand and 400 rand a gram. And he does the sums in his affidavit. He says if a member of a grow club receives 60 grams of indoor grown cannabis every 3 months and sells it for 400 rand a gram, the member will make 24,000 rand, with the equivalent of 8,000 rand a month. And if he joins 3 grow clubs, those numbers become 72,000 and 24,000 rand a month. And then you multiply that, let's say it's all of the foot soldiers of a particular particular gangster's operation, it could be thousands and thousands of rands which are every month which are being laundered in this way, produced in this way for sale. He also says, Colonel Smith, to determine whether a large-scale cannabis growing operation is a grow club and is not being abused by any of its operators, because it could be an employee isolated, or by any of the members on whose behalf the cannabis is extensively being grown. He says that will be a very difficult task. And if you've got tens of thousands of members in a club, it will be extremely difficult and time consuming if it can be achieved at all, and it will require a large deployment of scarce police resources. And bear in mind, lady, that Colonel Smith is making this affidavit on behalf of, amongst others, the Minister of Peace and the Minister of Justice. He's duly authorised to do so. This is the government speaking to you.
I understand that, but how do they intend to deal with these issues when they do legalise it?
That
because based on the Master Plan and based on the legislative intention, it seems that they do want to open the industry up, make it legal, leave the social economic benefits of it. These are all issues that they are going to have to face with.
Yes, but I agree completely with that, but the context will be totally different. The context then will be a general permission for the commercial production of cannabis and hemp. And there will then be regulation of that in order to try and mitigate the adverse impacts, which there will be, of that policy change. To the current situation where there's a general prohibition. That's what Colonel Smith is saying. He says that if this court were in the context of a general prohibition to create this exception, it will give rise to very serious policing problems. He's quite upfront and fair about it, speaking for the government. He says the government has a plan to commercialise. We are busy with that. But that is something which requires close and careful regulation. It's a multi-agency inquiry being led by the Department of Health on this aspect. There's going to have to be amendments to the Drugs Act and so on. But that brings me to another point that I'll get to in a moment. Is precisely, that is something which must be left to the government to deal with. The applicants are seeking to place the court in an invidious position where if one simply to decriminalise this, in the current context, and unless and until the government changes the legislation on this, the evidence is, and it's inherently plausible evidence, that it will cause significant policing problems. It will be very difficult, very time consuming, and will require large deployments of police resources, which are scarce. I want to take this point any further. I'm going to return to it in another context in a moment about permitting. As far as the prohibition on working on the gardener or the culturally is concerned, you'd say that's not absolute. I don't infringe this, but it's absolute as far as working for a grow club is concerned. Yes, that is so, but it's not absolute in absolute terms. You can, with the permit, be so lawfully so occupied. We submit that there is a close relationship between, on the one hand, the prohibition on establishing and running a cannabis grow club, and the prohibition on working as a gardener, etc., for such a club, and on the other hand, the purpose of the prohibition, which in the current environment is curbing dealing in cannabis. Returning to the constraints on South Africa's policing, administrative and financial resources, we submit, this is the evidence, that it will not be practically feasible in the current legislative environment to achieve the state's objective of curbing dealing in cannabis while permitting grow clubs and permitting people to work as horticulturists and gardeners in such clubs. I ask rhetorically whether one can imagine the proliferation of cannabis grow clubs. There will be an instant explosion of this phenomenon.
So we have to stop our clubs.
So there are problems with illegal dealing, there are costs and difficulties attendant on policing them, but one would have to create a permit system, and Colonel Smith deals with this in paragraph 289 of his affidavit. And he says that would probably then have to be introduced, but the setting up and implementation of such system in this environment would be difficult and expensive, and there would be a large potential for corruption because of the high value industry in which it would operate. So all of this goes to whether there's a least restrictive means. And we submit that this is par excellence a case in which the national government and parliament should be afforded a margin of appreciation among the CC authorities. And then the last factor, which if the others have viewed individually, cumulatively aren't decisive, has to be decisive, is the separation of power. The courts heard arguments both ways on this. Our argument is straightforward. That principle requires that the executive and ultimately parliament and not the courts determine whether cannabis grow clubs are to be decriminalised and if so, how they should be regulated. We refer in this regard to the statement in the ITAC case, which is quoted in the Auto matter, which we in turn have cited in our heads at Paro 182, note 146. Is that the primary responsibility of a court is not to make decisions reserved for within the domain of other branches of government, but rather to ensure that the concerned branches of government exercise the authority within the bounds of the Constitution. This would especially be so when the decision in issue is policy laden as well as polycentric. Polycentric is like a spider's web. If you pull on one thread, it distorts in a particular way. If you pull on another, it will distort in a different way from a different perspective. That's many different centres, and there's a lot of conflicting, potentially conflicting interests at stake. We refer to the Cabinet decision of July 2019 that the country needs a national strategy to commercialise cannabis in order to increase economic growth, create jobs, and alleviate poverty. We refer to the master plan, and in particular to the discussion in Section 7 of the need for effective regulatory systems to which I've referred. That talks to developing a new regulatory framework for hemp and marijuana, and the importance of establishing a new legal regime, clear to the general public, industry stakeholders and law enforcement agency, with enforceable rules corresponding penalties that are proportional to contraventions. All of that is the business of legislation, with respect not the business of the court. We submit evidence from this, as well as from the rest of the plan, that the commercialisation of the cultivation of and trade in cannabis is indeed a complex, multifaceted and policy-laden matter, and is moreover one which is currently receiving the attention of the executive. The master plan, in other words, envisages that the executive will develop a new regulatory framework and that Parliament will establish a new legal regime. And for all of these reasons, we submit that the limitation by the current legal dispensation of the right of citizens to choose the cannabis cannabis grow and can trade freely, and to choose the trade of cannabis horticulturist and gardener freely is justified under section 36(1) of the Constitution. And the same we respectfully submit would apply to any limitations of other rights which the court might find to have been established. That brings me lastly to remedy. The court would have seen from the heads of argument on both sides some attention is given to not just the declarations of invalidity under 172(1A), but what if they were to be made? What about retrospectivity, suspension, and so on and so forth? And as my learned friend pointed out in paragraph 2 of the Prince judgment, it was held that it's not for the High Court to engage in that process, so we have nothing, no submissions on that. And we do submit that if the court were against the state on this matter, the orders it should make should be an order in terms of 172(1A), declaring the illegality, no reading ins, etc., are sought here, and an order referring the matter to the Constitutional Court for confirmation. My learned friend is right. My clients do not seek costs against the applicants through the application to dismiss. Accordingly, prayer is that the relief sought in part be of the applicant's notice of motion to dismiss.
I don't think you want to address me on the position pertaining to cost after that has done so in respect of the or acting further on, should they be successful.
I will, if necessary, I very much doubt about no doubt she will correct you. Summarize the law, but it's true. Thank you.
Thank you, Marilyn. I'm going to be very brief in reply. I intend dealing with first to make a few general or perhaps one or two just general observations. Second, to deal with the question of primary relief, just in certain limited respects. Third, to deal with questions of the alternative relief in limited respects, and finally, to deal with the question of remedy and costs. My lady, the first, under the first of those headings, just a general point, and that is this. My learned friend expressed some, or raised the point that this was the first time where a statute is being challenged on the back of a constitutional court judgment which provided for certain certain relief. And I want to make two points on that. The first is, your ladyship will be aware, and I gave the court the references this morning, the constitutional court determined Prince 3 only on the basis of the right to privacy. Your ladyship is fully aware that the constitutional relief sought in this application is founded on four rights which do not include the right to privacy. And so we submit there's nothing untoward or obscure about that. It's a constitutional challenge premised on rights which we contend are infringed in this instance, which were never ventilated before the Constitutional Court. The other issue, as your ladyship will know from our heads of argument, in any event, there is already a challenge in the offing on, as I have it, on its way up to the Constitutional Court, where the Prince 3 judgment, the impact of the Prince 3 judgment referring to adults only, is being challenged as being under-inclusive because it doesn't refer to children. So there's nothing uneasy or that stands in the way of the court to grant the relief sought. The second issue is, and I'm not going to belabor the issue of the primary relief sought in this application, but I would like to refer the court to the definition of deal in, and we accept that that definition creates an exclusion that applies to cultivate only. But of course, the import of reading that in a way that says you have an exclusion in relation to cultivate only, which has no bearing on any of the other elements of the term deal in, is the following. It's quoted in our learned friend's note at page 14. Can I ask the court to go there? Page 14, paragraph 21.1. Refers to performing any act in connection with the collection, supply, transmission of the drug. So if one were to say the exception applies only to cultivate, it of course begs the question as to how cultivation cannot take place if there isn't some generous meaning to be given to the terms collection or transmission. And I mustn't be misunderstood in making that submission to be suggesting that it's, perhaps let me frame it this way. I accept unreservedly that the Constitutional Court didn't go down the road of the invalidating the purchase prohibitions. So none of what I say must be construed as suggesting otherwise than that. But there's another reason that this is so. It's an interesting point, and that is because if one contrasts the definition in the Drugs Act as it stands with some of the definitions in the bill, can I ask the court to go to page 32 of our heads of argument? What's significant about it is if the court has regard to the definition of possess in private for the purposes of those sections, it refers to keeping, storing, transporting, or being in control of cannabis or cannabis plant, respectively, in a manner that conceals it from public view. And then if the court has regard to the definition of private place under the bill, it refers to various instances to which the public does not have access. Those are terms which the legislative process in and of itself at this stage considered to be appropriate. And then the court will see that on the definition of deal in, this is significant, it doesn't refer to cultivate. It says provide for consideration, receive for consideration, sell, buy, offer for sale, offer to purchase, import, advertise for sale, export, and any other conduct to facilitate selling. And I would submit to your ladyship that those definitions which appear in the bill itself underscore the importance of not giving too narrow a definition to the exception created under the cultivate threshold in the deal. On the question then of the alternative relief, I'm not going to dwell on this too much, but the import of the submissions made on behalf of the state was to say, well, because Prince 3 provides for cultivation and use and possession for personal consumption, you can never have a gardener or somebody else who's working in your garden tending to a cannabis plant. And one just needs to state that to understand what the import is of what's being said. It means that I would in effect or possibly have a 20 square meter backyard garden. I employ a gardener to work in that garden. I have two cannabis plants in that garden which take up 1 square meter. The input import of the Prince judgment according to the state is that the gardener will not be able to work over the 1 square meter because it will amount to horticultural or gardening services in the absence of a permit. And I would submit to your ladyship that such a reading of the Prince judgment, or indeed the resultant legislation, could never be sanctioned. It really isn't borne out by the wording as it stands. My lady, I'm not going to dwell on the rights infringements. I've foreshadowed, and I would submit to your ladyship that because there is a conceded infringement of the Section 22 rights, of which dignity is a constituent element, the infringement in the constitutional analysis has been shown. It follows from that that the only question for adjudication is the question of the justification. And there, our learned friends and us aren't apart on the legal principles around the justification. The only difference lies in an application of those principles to the evidence that is before your ladyship. And on that, we make the following submissions. The first is, of course, on less restrictive means, one doesn't elevate that to the sole criterion against which a limitations analysis takes place. But of course, we know from the reading of the case law, which I took the court to, that if there is a breach of a right and there is a less restrictive means by which to address it, a court would be hard-pressed to find that there's proportionality and balancing in the limitations inquiry. Differently put, the court is not in a position to wish away a breach of a constitutional right and to say, notwithstanding the fact that there may be other less restrictive means, I won't sanction it as a reasonable and justifiable limitation. Then, my lord, it's not that my learned friend may have misheard or misunderstood me. My submission was not that there's no justification for the assertion that policing is difficult and costly. As your ladyship will be aware, I took the court through to page 413 of the papers, and I went through each of those items paragraph by paragraph, and I reached to the conclusion that those, whether separately considered or cumulatively considered, did not rise to the threshold that the Constitutional Court has set out for a justification analysis. The next point is, when the court writes this judgment, it will have before it page 413 and following of the record and paragraphs 49 and 50 of the necro judgment. And for reasons that I've submitted, we say that it doesn't meet the threshold of the necro judgment. Submitted based on what was included, I think, top of page 414, which is that grow club operators may intersperse the cannabis of members with cannabis of their own. And your ladyship correctly, I would submit, raised the question of the speculative basis for such an assertion. And what's striking about that is that if one looks at it as to the factual and policy considerations that the state must put before court, one would conclude, I'd submit, that there's no base, it's entirely speculative. The state's case isn't that when we went to this grow club in October 2020, we saw in between these different cannabis plants, we saw a bunch of cannabis or a whole lot of cannabis that was for personal use or that was for trading or whatever it is beyond this. There's no evidence of that. The deponent also doesn't say to this court, there are other cannabis grow club models elsewhere. This is what we've witnessed in relation to it. And when your ladyship engaged with my learned friend on that, he referred the court to paragraph 36 of NICRO. I won't go back there, but the submission is that when one looks at this against paragraph 36 of NICRO, paragraph 36 of NICRO still says that the factual allegations and the policy considerations need to be placed before court. And the important thing on this is a point I foreshadowed in my argument in chief, and that is that there's no suggestion that that the grow club model is different from other permitting regimes, such that the grow club model presents a risk that does not appear in relation to other permitting initiatives. And the high watermark of it is it's a valuable output that we've got in here. It's open to abuse, and there's a high incentive or risk for people going in and committing robberies, etc. But of course, that begs the question, what renders this model susceptible to all of those risks and not any of the other lawful cannabis models which allow for cultivation? And on the figures that I've given, I think it's midway through page 415 or 414, where the deponent speaks to what the costs and what a high value commodity this is, etc. Of course, one could test it in many different ways, my lady. Assuming I were, as my lady junior pointed out to me, assuming I had five different properties, a farmhouse, a beach house, a primary residence at two other out-of-town properties. And I chose to exercise my right to cultivate cannabis in private on each of those properties. The risk about it being used for trading purposes or dealing would apply in the very same way. And so the submission is that there's nothing unique or different about this grow club model that shows an added risk in relation to it. My lady, much was said about the doctrine of separation of powers on this, and let me perhaps just frame it in this way. The primary question before this court is, firstly, is there an infringement of a constitutional right? Secondly, if there is an infringement, has the justification analysis been passed? And thirdly, if it hasn't, what is the appropriate remedy? And when one deals with remedy, the court will be cautious about overstepping the mark in light of the doctrine of separation of powers. But what the doctrine doesn't sanction is where there's an established unconstitutionality and a failure to get past the hurdle of a justification. For the court to turn its eye on a litigant and say, I'm constrained by virtue of the doctrine of separation of powers in finding an unconstitutionality and in remediating that unconstitutionality. The court will be aware that in the jurisprudence of the Constitutional Court, and it appears, I think, at paragraph 102 and following of Prince 3, where the court dealt with remedy, that what looms large in the mind of the court is granting an effective remedy once the infringement and the justification analysis has been passed. And as I have already argued, that effective remedy isn't, we submit with respect, aimed at directing government to pass legislation, aimed at directing government to adopt a particular policy stance, the court will know there have been other courts that have gone a lot further, directing government to adopt legislation on matters. This is not one of those cases. The ambit of it, I would submit, is very, very narrow. Then, my lady, on the final issue of remedy, I agree with my learned friend, Ms. Redmer, that it really is a Section 172.1a order that this court will be making, declaring it unconstitutional. I've taken the court through already the parts that we're no longer pursuing on that, and the just and equitable part of it, 172.1b, would be an argument in the Constitutional Court if we get there for another day. On the question of costs, I said to your ladyship at the outset that we are acting pro bono in the matter. Your ladyship is aware that at page 5 of our heads of argument, we did actually seek an order for costs on this. And it seems to me on my reading of section 92 of the Legal Practice Act, costs may be recovered by legal practitioners rendering free legal services. And I'll ask your ladyship just to have regard to that provision in its entirety. And my submission would be on a proper reading of section 92, even if services are being rendered on a pro bono basis, if a costs order is granted, it ought to inure to the benefit of the legal practitioners. My lady, those are my submissions. I'm indebted to the court.
I have no submissions on the question of costs.
Do the parties prefer for judgment to be limited in tribunal or in person, or do they have any preference?
No preference from our side, I'm told, my lady.